God is good all the time.
All the time, God is good.
All the time, God is good. Let's give the Lord a hand of praise. Amen. God is still a healer right here in our midst. Amen. So we just declare his healing right now. There's a word, I don't want to keep you long, and so we're going to go ahead and move forward with the word. Thank you for those who are attending for Brother Willie right now. This has been a tough week for all of those who have family in Florida. Yes. Amen. My sister was in Jacksonville, and before the final path of the hurricane was determined, everybody everywhere in Florida was nervous. And it was only a matter of time. It was like, you know, for me, it was like, sis, when you getting out of there? Because they had to go. And so finally, on Friday morning, about 3 o'clock in the morning, she and her husband took off for Atlanta. And, of course, it's a 5-hour drive that took them about 12 hours. And she called me along the way. All along the way, there were people who had come down from the Keys. They had been traveling all night long. There were hundreds and hundreds of cars along the highway, along the way. When they went to the McDonald's to get something to eat, the McDonald's was out of food. They couldn't go to the bathroom because all the bathrooms were broken. And it was one of those trying times. But it is in those trying times that sometimes we find humor. And so as she rolled down the road, my sister started asking me if I remembered what we used to do in the early weeks of September, because we, in California, we started school the second week of September. And so the first week of September was something special in our household. And it was interesting because what we did for my sister and I is we spent most of the first week in September in the bathroom. But some of y'all don't really get this because you don't understand what was going on, but my parents came from Arkansas, and so though we lived in California, we sort of lived the southern life, and for them, you had to prepare your body after being on vacation. You had to prepare yourself in order to be around a whole bunch of other people with a whole bunch of other germs. And so what she did, what my mother did, and my grandmother, what they did was they prepared for us a bunch of concoctions. And so you may not know, has anybody here ever heard of Sinaleaf tea? Sinaleaf tea is one of the most powerful herbal laxatives that you can find in all the world. And she made us drink this stuff, and Lord. Right now, to this day, if someone was boiling Sinaleaf tea in their house, I would walk in their house and walk immediately to the bathroom. Because it's rough. This stuff is rough. But my grandmother would say, well, baby, if you clean on the inside, if everything is clean, then you won't get sick. And I just looked at her as I was preparing to run to the bathroom. But there was all of these things that our grandparents used to give us. That was so interesting. We also had to take turpentine. Any of y'all take turpentine? Turpentine and sugar. Hell no. Turpentine and poison.
Y'all, anybody?
getting a doctor. And we didn't have a pharmacy that we walked down the street and could get medicine. So they had all of these cures from back in the day that was handed down from generation to generation that they knew would work that seemed absolutely ridiculous to us. I talked to my wife, and I rarely see her these days, but she said that she had sinus problems, and her grandmother would take a grapefruit, cut it in half, put honey on it, sprinkle cayenne on top of it, and then bake it. And then she would have to eat it all. I said, that was nasty. She said, that was nasty. But she didn't have any sinus problems. And so it is these kinds of remedies and solutions that are handed down from generation to generation, the wisdom of our grandparents that help us along the way. And so many times, we need to understand that it is the responsibility of grandparents to pass down the wisdom that they've had over the years. Now, our grandchildren don't make it easy for us. Yes. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Because most of the time, depending on how old they are, they think they're smarter than us anyway. And so I used to remember, I got touched a few times when my grandmother was trying to tell me something. And I roll my eyes. Lord, help me. I couldn't duck fast enough. She said, you're going to roll them in the back of the head. I'm going to knock them in the back of the head. But grandparents are special in that way because they have a wisdom. And they have a certain insight that is supposed to be handed down from generation to generation. That's what Moses was talking about in our scripture this morning in Deuteronomy 6. He said, look here, there are things that you need to tell your children and their children so that they can lead a good life. And here's something I want you to understand and know this morning. God desires for his children to live a prosperous life. Somebody needs to say amen to that. I don't think you got that. God wants you, no matter what you're going through right now, he wants you to live a prosperous life. That has always been the design. He said, look here, I'm going to give you rules, I'm going to give you decrees, but if you are obedient, I'm getting ready to put you in the promised land. And see, we all have a promised land from God. I know the children of Israel had the place across the Jordan that they have to go through. But you see, we have a Jordan to cross too. We have a place that God wants us to go that is a difficult, challenging place. But if we can get there, if we can be obedient, if we can just follow the instructions of God, he says, I'm going to bless you in this land of milk and honey. I'm going to bless you in a land that has everything that you need to be prosperous. I'm going to bless you.
Amen.
But you see, in order to make it, you're going to have to listen to your grandparents. Because what they have is essential if the next generation is going to make it. So as I continue in this series, Driving Love, last week we talked about no ordinary love, and this week I want to talk about sharing loving wisdom. Sharing loving wisdom. Let's pray. Lord God, in the name of Jesus, we just give you glory this morning. And ask, Lord God, that you would move in the name of Jesus. Open up ears. Open up hearts this morning and give your word. And we'll give you the glory and the honor and the praise. In the name of Jesus, we pray and say amen.
Amen.
So there's two things, two words that we need to really understand this morning as we go down this path on this journey. The first is love. Love is this special affection and attachment or enthusiasm that results in caring, self-sacrifice, and service. You see, love is just not a word. It is not a noun. Love is a verb. And, you know, verbs are action words. And so when we talk about love, we don't talk about what you say. We talk about what you do.
That's right.
Love is something that you show. Love is the action behind a feeling. And the other word is wisdom. And wisdom is knowledge based on experience, observation, careful attention, instruction, and revelation of a course of action that will please God. In other words, that you have to live a little bit to get some wisdom. Amen? Wisdom is not something that you get when you are a teenager and you're young. You see, you have to go through a little bit to have wisdom. It takes a few ups and downs in your life before you have a little bit of wisdom. And with the wisdom of God, it takes a little bit for you to really understand how great God really is. But it takes a little time for you to understand that you cannot do it on your own. That it takes a little bit of help from the Lord our Savior if you're going to be able to make it. And once you get this wisdom and understanding about what the Lord does, it changes how you live your life. Because you know there's no need of you calling your cousin, no need of you calling your best friend. What you need to do is get down on your knees and call on the Lord, because He is the only one who can help you, and you learn that when you go through. See, we didn't have that when we were young. We thought we could do it all. We thought we were big enough and bad enough and sassy enough that we didn't need no help. But you see, once life starts hitting you upside your head, once life really gets you and you get to understand that everybody who says they like you don't like you, and everybody who says they love you don't love you.
Just telling them what they need to do, it is living the life
because they are watching. There are some of us who are visual learners more than readers or even listeners, and what you see is what you do, and we just have to make sure in all that we do that we understand that as grandparents, we have a certain responsibility to raise up the children in the way that they could go. You see, and I know it gets tough. I know it's difficult, but the Bible said, and Moses told us that, he said, tell your children and your children's children, he said, talk to them. Talk to them. And see, now, it's so tough. It's so tough because there's so many distractions. We can't even have Thanksgiving dinner. I wish that there was a way that if we had Thanksgiving dinner and all the kids were there, we could press the button and they had no internet access. Right. Wouldn't that change then? They would be upset. But we don't have our opportunities now to talk to our children and our children's children have been taken away because of all of the distractions and all of the things that are going on, but we have a responsibility to plant that seed. We have to do it. And I'm here to let you know that when we plant that seed in love and we provide wisdom, there is something special about the seed of a grandparent. There's something special about sharing loving wisdom. You see, what we need to understand, even though it looks like they're not paying no attention, no matter how hard we try, no matter how much we do, it looks like we might as well be talking to the wall. But there's something special about what we tell them, because God has told us this is our responsibility. So even though we don't see it bearing fruit immediately, we have to know that seed has been planted. And the Bible tells us, it says in Proverbs, it tells us to raise up a child in the way that they would go.
That's right.
And then it says, and when they are old. You see, it didn't say that when they are a teenager and they know everything. When they're a teenager, and like my parents used to tell me, they could smell themselves. When they're teenagers, and like they used to say back in the day, it was too big for their britches. When they're a teenager and they know that they know more than you'll ever know in your life, somehow, I don't know how this happens, somehow our brilliant children can't add up. And if we got to the age where we are, we must have been their age too. We had to go through. We had our challenges. They may have been different challenges, but watch this. See, we look at our children as all the challenges, but our parents look at us and say, they have been, every generation has greater challenges than the past generation. Amen. But the one thing that we have is we have God on our side through all generations. We can cut through a lot of that muck and mire and that mess in the name of Jesus. And it's great because you see, what we have to do is we have to plant the seed. We have to tell them. If we don't plant the seed, then there is nothing that will bring them back to where they need to be once they get some sense. Because once they get into, once you get into your late 20s and you figure out you can't make it on your own, once you get into your late 20s and you find out this world is out to take you out, once you get old enough and you figure out, my goodness, where did I go wrong? Then you begin to search for a solution. And instead that you might wander in the church, and instead that somebody mentions Jesus, and instead that seed that has been planted in there by your grandparents decades ago, all of a sudden it takes root and begins to grow. All of a sudden, how many of us remember that? All of a sudden, I didn't know where to go, but all of a sudden I knew that I called on the name of Jesus. I didn't understand it all, but I remember what my grandmother used to say, that if you pray, God will hear you. And I needed some help, and I couldn't talk to anybody else. I needed some help, and there was no place to go. I needed some help. I was lost in darkness. I had given everything a try. I tried marijuana. I tried liquor. I tried drugs. I tried it all. But now it was time that I tried Jesus. Grandmother seed, grandma plants a deer. seeds that were planted so very deep. The seed of love. And you see, love changes everything.
Yes,
hallelujah. Thank you. Thank you, Grandma, for praying for me when I ain't had no sense.
Yes, sir.
Praying for me, Lord God, in the deep darkness. Thank you, Lord God. See, and when I talk about grandparents and grandmothers, as it said earlier, it's not always about blood. Amen. Because there's some older folks in our family who didn't have no children, who were grandparents to us all. Amen. For those, because they too prayed for us. They got on their knees and they prayed because they knew we were lost. Watch this. But a lot of folks know we were lost because we were going down the same road that they were on.
That's right.
Amen.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Thank you, Lord.
I'm going to tell you, I knew I was smart. So I'm going to tell you, some of you all will get this. So I'm at the house, and we go have dinner. And I roll in with rose-colored glasses. It'll take a while. And I'm sitting up at my table. I didn't even wear glasses. I didn't wear any glasses at all. I had great 20/20 vision. I roll in to sit down at the table with my parents with rose-colored glasses. Then I stood up and my little bottle of Visine fell out of my pocket.
Yes, sir.
Somebody know what I'm talking about.
Yes, sir.
Down. Amen?
Amen.
We really know. out. Now, if you insist, you can go on down there if you want to, but I'm going to tell you there is some problems and some troubles and some dark times and some ugly times if you continue to do what you have been doing. But I've got to share. I've got to tell you what you're supposed to do, because the word says impress them on your children. Talk about it when you sit at home and when you walk along the road, when you're riding in your car. Don't say riding in the car, but when you're moving with your children, when you lie down and when you get up, we have to be consistently sharing with our children and our children's children the dangers of the world and the blessings of our God. If we know what God can do, do not be hesitant to share that with them, because they may not understand at 19, but about 29, they're going to understand a little bit better what our God can do. Amen?
Amen.
And I have to, I really have to let you, we have to live this thing. We cannot simply talk about it. We have to live it every single day. We have to live for the love of God. We have to live it like we know that we love God and they can see that we love God. We have to live our service in the church. We have to live those things that we do. We have to let them see us going to Bible study. Let them see us going to church. And when we go to church, can we have a good attitude? They're watching you go to church. You're like, oh Lord, I don't want to go this morning. Oh, geez, oh, I guess I'll go. I sure hope that preacher don't preach long this morning. What are you telling me? See, we grew up back in the day. Listen, Sunday was church day. That's what we did. All day Sunday was church day. Now, Sunday is a quick break of 2 hours. Get in, get out, so I can go back to doing whatever it is like I want to do. And the only time we really get serious about it is when we get sick. All of a sudden, when we get sick, our conversations on the phone change. Baby, I need you to pray for me. You weren't that one. They are watching us. How are they to know what the love of the Lord is really like unless they see it in us? How are they to know about our dependence on the Lord unless they see it in us?
Yes.
They're watching. And they can tell, trust me, they can tell that you act different on Monday than you did on Sunday. You talk different on Sunday than you did on Monday. You dress differently on Monday than you did on Sunday. Huh? It is our responsibility to show love, to demonstrate love, to give wisdom and knowledge to those who are coming behind us. We have to reach back. We've got to. And we've got to tell them while they're young so the seed can be planted. Amen. So they will know where to go, because it says, and when they are old, they will not depart from it. But if you don't give them something while they're young, they won't have anything when they're old. Amen?
Amen.
So it is this awesome responsibility. And the thing is that we do this so that they can be blessed. See, this whole God thing isn't about our blessing. It's about the blessing of our children and our children's children. This same God that saved you in the midst of your mess. The same God that saved you when you were lost. The same God that saved you when you didn't think you turned around. The same God that saved you, hallelujah, is the God who will be able to save them too.
Amen.
They've got to see it.
Amen.
They've got to see joy when you go to church. Oh, watch this, I'm about to get in trouble. But I saw this. They've got to see you when you pay your tithes.
Because
see, when they see, when they have offering, and you pull out a dollar to give it to them, and then you put a dollar in the plate. What you're saying is, this is how we give to God. What you're saying is, this is how I say thanks to God. Then you drive home and stop at the liquor store and... bottle of wine costs more than a dollar. Yeah. And they're watching. Uh-huh. They're watching. Amen. So today I just want to encourage us all. Because they're watching us all. Yes. That we have a responsibility to the young ones.
Yes, we do.
To show them the way.
Yeah.
We have a responsibility to show them the joy of the Lord that say is our strength. We have a responsibility that when we sing a song about blessed assurance, we live like we know we have blessed assurance. We have a responsibility because they are watching us. So never forget that all of the young ones are watching us. And our responsibility is to share. It's okay if we share the experiences of the bad times so that they can understand how we made it to the good times.
Thank you, Lord.
It's okay to turn off the TV sometimes and tell them to put their phone and turn it off sometimes just so you can have a little conversation about life and what you went through so that they can have all the things that they have. Why they are so blessed and why they're able to the Lord. Why they continue to get gifts and love. We have to tell them that it is God on our side that makes this happen.
Thank you, Lord.
Yes. And know that God is faithful.
Yes.
Yes.
And in their time of struggle.
Yes, sir.
Hallelujah.
Yes, sir.
See, I don't know. I don't know your story. I don't know how God got you. I don't know where he found you.
Uh-huh.
Some of you, he might have found you in a nice place.
Come on. That's right.
But for some of us, hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord.
He gave us a testimony that no matter where you are,
hallelujah,
our God can come and get you. See, sometimes we need, because we look good now. We could look good now. We rolling good now. We got fancy cars. We got fancy houses. We got fancy shoes. We got fancy purses. We got all this good stuff. But it wasn't always that way.
That's right. Thank you, Lord.
Because the same people we hung out with, it's not that way with them now. Because if it had not been for the Lord on our side. Oh, I mean, somebody needs to be happy about the Lord who is on our side, who has given us this experience that we can share with somebody to tell somebody that Jesus saved. No matter how dark and dreary it is, our Jesus saved in the name of Jesus. Stand up all over the house.
Yes, sir.
In the name of Jesus. We just need to celebrate Jesus. Can we give the Lord a hand, praise? We celebrate Jesus for all of our experiences, and we celebrate Jesus for all of those that he placed in our lives. I want to thank all of the grandparents, all of the warriors of wisdom, those who have made it through, as my mother would say, the rough side of the mountain.
Thank you.
And aren't afraid to share, and mostly, thank you, that you're not ashamed to pray. Because we all still need prayer. Because there's temptations out there everywhere. So for our younger ones, on this Grandparents' Day, thank you to the grandparents and the elders and the oldest. You just need to say thank you for praying for me. And you know who they are. Just say thank you for praying for me. I don't know when you prayed or how you prayed, but I know that I made it here today. Because somebody prayed for me, I had me on their mind, but took the time and prayed for me. I'm so glad they prayed. I'm so glad they prayed. I'm so glad they prayed for me. My mother So be with us, Lord God, as we press forward and be with our children, our children's children, and our children's children's children. That they may grow to know and understand through our experience that we serve an awesome God. It is absolutely none like Him. Help us, Lord God, to not be afraid to share the glory of your story, that lives may be changed in the name of Jesus. So we thank you, Lord God, for loving wisdom and all those who have shared with us over the years. And Lord God, to God be the glory as we ask that our children and children's children are able to enter the promised land, that they would grow and prosper and live the good life that you have for them. In the awesome name of Jesus, we pray, and all God's children say,
Amen.
Amen. You, Lord, have grace with them.
Thank you for joining us this morning. Check us out. Check out our upcoming events and see you next Sunday.